In this step, we're going to realize the lumped element resonators using transmission lines. In particular, we want to get rid of the inductor, because basically inductors are pretty poor at microwave frequencies. And we're going to realize the same functionality using a transmission line. Now, let me make an aside here. We're not just talking about designing a parallel coupled line bandpass filter here. We're covering the basic ideas behind passive microwave design. So the ideas that we're talking about here have broad applicability, and the ideas that we're developing and using can be used in nearly any field. The idea is that we are following a synthesis process, and we are making design decisions all the time to give us the type of response that we want and to get around any difficulties that we come across. Let's get back to the conversion of the lumped element resonators into a resonator which consists of a transmission line and a capacitor. So here is the central idea. We are trying to obtain a broadband realization of the LC resonators in the bandpass filter without using inductors. And we're going to realize the LC resonant circuit by a circuit with a capacitor and a stub. So this is an invention, and we collect some of these ideas in our little bag of tricks. And the way we're going to equate these two circuits, the circuit on the left, which is just the LC resonator, with the circuit on the right, which has a stub, a short-circuited stub in this case, and a capacitor, is that we're going to equate the admittances and the derivatives of the admittances. Now, before we do that, let's look at a narrowband realization of the resonator. And we're going to obtain a narrowband resonator equivalence at a radian frequency omega zero. When we use F0 or omega zero, we're talking about the center frequency of our design in nearly all cases. In this case, F0 or omega zero is going to be the resonant frequency of our LC resonator, and that is also the center frequency of the bandpass filter that we're designing. Now, looking at the LC resonator, it has 2 degrees of freedom. We can change the capacitance value, and we can change the inductor value. If we look at a short-circuited stub here, this also has 2 degrees of freedom. We can change the characteristic impedance of the stub, and we can change the electrical length of the stub. Now, the convention that we use when we draw a stub is that we can put the characteristic impedance of the stub down. In this case, it's Z01, and the Z0 indicates that it is a characteristic impedance, and Z1 is the impedance looking into the stub. Usually in a design, all stubs have the same length, and we'll say a little bit more about that later on. If we try and match these two circuits, each circuit has 2 degrees of freedom, we can only achieve a match at one frequency. And it'll be a reasonable match within a few percent of that frequency. With the bandpass filter that we want to design, we really need to achieve a broadband match. And this is how we do it. Here is our original resonator, just LNC. It has 2 degrees of freedom. And here is the stub in parallel with the capacitor, and it has 3 degrees of freedom. And they are the characteristic impedance of the stub. Of course, that's going to be real, it's not going to be complex, and the electrical length of the stub. And the third degree of freedom comes from C0. So the broadband match at omega zero is obtained by matching Y in and the derivative of Y in with respect to radian frequency at omega zero. Here is our Y in and the derivative of Y in for our lumped element resonator. And a little bit more complex, and boy, it takes a while to get this right. We have the input admittance of our hybrid stub and capacitor circuit and its derivative. Now, we've introduced here another little term. Remember that I said that we have a degree of freedom, which is the electrical length of that stub. And it turns out a very convenient way of defining that electrical length is introducing a variable which defines the frequency at which that stub is resonant. Well, of course, it's the first frequency of resonance. The stub is first resonant when it is lambda on for long. The input impedance of the shorted stub will be infinity, that is, it will look like an open circuit when it is lambda on for long, and it will be lambda on for long at what is called the resonant frequency of the stub and it is also called the commensurate frequency, so that the commensurate frequency is not the same as the center frequency of the design. And that commensurate frequency is FR, or in radian frequency, it'll be omega R. So we've introduced that quantity, and that will turn out to be a very important quantity. So now we're going to equate the admittances. Y in is the admittance looking into our lumped LC circuit, and Y in prime is the admittance looking into the hybrid circuit. And of course, we want to equate the derivatives. Now we need to make a specific design choice. And the design choice that is most commonly made is for omega R to be 2 omega 0, or FR is equal to 2 F0. Or another way of saying the same thing is to say that the commensurate frequency is twice the center frequency of the filter. This is the most common choice. But we could pick omega R to have a different relationship to omega 0 than simply a factor of 2. And right at the very end of this PCL design, we're going to talk about the implication of a different design choice. For the admittances of the networks to be equivalent, this is the value that we need for C0. You'll see C0 is a function of C and L and Z01. So let's say we got the value of Z01 wrong. That would mean that we'd have to change the value of C0 to ensure that the admittances are equivalent. And when we equate the derivatives, well, we end up becoming a little bit more restrictive. Z01 is now a function of L, so that in this expression, Z0 is a function of L. Well, here's L on its own, here's C, so it is fixed. And so C0 is fixed. In fact, the only variable in here that we can play around with is this commensurate frequency. So we could change that commensurate frequency if we wanted to, and we'd have a different value of capacitor. Still, the most common choice is for the commensurate frequency to be twice the center frequency of the filter. Now there's an interesting byproduct by making this choice, that omega R is equal to 2 omega 0. And that means that Z1, the impedance looking into the shorted stub, is just going to be JZ01. So that is very convenient. So if we have a 50 ohm transmission line, which is shorted, and we make the choice that the commensurate frequency is twice our operating frequency, then Z1 is just JZ01. So Z01 is 50 ohms, then Z1 will be J50. So now let's return to our filter. The commensurate frequency, FR, of the design is the resonant frequency of the stubs. By default, all of the stubs have the same FR. We need to be very careful if we're doing a design where the stubs in a circuit have a different FR. But rarely is there a reason for FRs to be different in a circuit. The design choice here is that FR is equal to 2F0, where F0 is the center frequency of the design. And just repeating with this design choice, Z1 is equal to J01. So Z01 is the characteristic impedance of the first stub. So its input impedance is J01, and so on for the other two shorted stubs. Now we need to be very careful about this choice of commensurate frequency. Many people will write papers, write books, when they write up their designs in a workbook, they will simply assume that the commensurate frequency is twice F0 because that has done so much. It is good practice to always specify what your choice is, because that is not the only choice. It's probably the choice used in 99% of cases, but when you're in trouble, you can make another choice. When you're in trouble could mean that the values are simply wrong. And as we will see, transmission lines introduce spurious passbands. It may be that you have to shift those spurious passbands around, and you can do that by changing the commensurate frequency. So in summary, at the end of step 5, this is where we are. We have a capacitance. This is our first resonator, C1 double prime, which is 21 picofarads. This will be the same as C3 triple prime because this is a symmetrical design. Z01 will be the same as Z03, and it is 7.54 ohms. C2 double prime, well, different value capacitors, 27 picofarads, and Z02 is 5.8 picofarads. So this is broadband, but there are some problems with this, which we're going to have to address. The stubs have different characteristic impedances, and not just that, these stubs will be realized using microstrip lines in our coupled line filter. And pretty much those characteristic impedances, pretty much I mean, you know, roughly within 70-80%, the characteristic impedances of those stubs will be the characteristic impedances of each of those individual microstrip lines. And of course, a line with 7.5 ohm characteristic impedance, or even 5.8 ohm characteristic impedance, which is even worse, is going to mean that our line has to be very wide. We would really rather not realize a microstrip line that has a characteristic impedance of, say, less than 30 ohms. So we're going to have to address that. We also want to make sure that those characteristic impedances are very close. So why do we want that? Well, we have to manufacture this circuit. We're going to do a better job of faithfully reproducing the filter and getting the response that we want when all of the widths are the same. At least if they're the same, if there's a little error, that little error will affect everything equally. Whereas if the widths are different, and let's say we have some tolerancing on our etching, if the widths are different, we're going to have a different impact on each of those resonators. It'll end up meaning that our filter will be a little bit more difficult to tune. Because, of course, every microwave filter must be tuned. When we go to manufacturing and we try and etch these microstrip lines, about the best dimensional control we can get is about 1%. This filter requires accuracy around about 0.1%, maybe even a little bit less than that, more like 0.01%. We cannot manufacture anything with that level of precision. Again, we really want our stubs to have the same characteristic impedance because they will be realized by microstrip lines, and we want them to have the same width. Kind of. We're a little bit imprecise at the moment because we have not realized the inverters yet.